confidentiality, integrity, and availability. If we do not address these three concerns in our security design, then most probably our system will get compromised soon. So what is meant by confidentiality? So confidentiality is only the intended recipient should be able to see. How do we achieve confidentiality? We achieve confidentiality by encrypting the messages. What is meant by integrity? Integrity means we send some data from one place to another place, and if that data got tampered in the middle, the recipient should be able to detect that this data is tampered, so that the recipient can safely. How do we protect our systems for integrity? That's by signing messages. Then the availability. So once again, like, there are so many other factors that we need to take into consideration when we design a system for high availability. Security is also a one key aspect. We need to take proper measures to protect our systems with DOS attacks, DDoS attacks, and different other attacks from different attacks. Okay. So when you design a system, you need to worry about all the connections in your system. Your system is as strong as the strength of the weakest link in your system. I can give you a good example. So there's a supermarket chain in France called Monoprix. Since 2006 to 2010, a gang of robbers were able to steal money from that supermarket chain, and it was around 600,000 euros. So they did steal in 4 years. How did they do that? So they studied how the Monoprix supermarket chain works. And the way it works is, from the cashier, from the cash register to the cash coffer, they transferred the money through a pneumatic suction tube. Right? You put money to this tube, and that tube will take that money to the cash coffer for the safe. Even though the cash coffer is extremely secured, highly secured, this gang of robbers found out the weakest link in this system is this pneumatic suction tube. So they used a powerful vacuum cleaner and drilled a hole in that pneumatic suction tube closer to the safe, and plugged the vacuum cleaner there and pumped out all the money going through the suction tube to the safe. And doing that, they were managed to steal 600,000 euros in 4 years. And the supermarket chain took 4 years to detect that problem. Then again, inside attacks. So who knows these guys? Who is in left? Snowden. This one? Bradley Mine. So from the US diplomatic cables leak through the WikiLeaks via Bradley Manning to the NSA secret operations disclosure by Edward Snowden. So all these are inside operations. So both these guys, they had legitimate access to data. They are not in fact hackers, right? They had legitimate access to data. They are authorized to access this data. So if you look at most of the attacks taking place today, 60 to 80% of those attacks are initiated by insiders. But most of the enterprises spend a lot of dollars, millions of dollars, protecting their systems against external attacks. Another thing we need to worry about is defense in depth. What does that mean? We may have a highly secured application, right? So we do authentication, we do authorization, everything, a client. But still, so as I said before, right? There's no like system that is 100% secure. We can only secure the systems to the knowledge we have, right? So that's why we cannot trust the security at any layer. So we need to have multiple layers. So you deploy the application, you have the application level security. So then again, at the perimeter level, so if you want to expose this application to external users, you need to have a firewall at the network perimeter. Then again, you will have a DMC. If you want to expose services to the outsiders, then once again, any traffic coming through the DMC to the internal network, that once again will flow through another firewall. Then again, you have the databases, there will be a firewall in front of the databases, and also you may have different security zones based on the confidentiality or the confidentiality of or the priority of your data or the applications. You may remember like in 2013 November, there was an attack took place in Los Angeles Airport. A guy with a gun entered into the airport. He went to the ticketing counter, got his boarding pass, and then at the gate. So most of the international airports, they do have this defense in depth security concept. They have security layers at different levels. But the first security layer in most of the airport is at the gate. Not at the gate, like at the time you go to the immigration, right? So this guy went to the immigration, then, so nobody checked him at that, till that point. Then he took his gun and fired to the TSA officers. In fact, one guy got killed. So he got to that layer, but since there's another layer after that, he couldn't get into flight and take control of flight. But if we had another layer in front of the immigration layer, security layer, maybe just to scan everyone enters the airport, right? We could have prevented the death of that TSA officer. So this is something you need to worry about, like when you design a system. But once again, it's based on your scenario. For example, we will never use like a security personnel and an expensive burglar alarm system to protect an empty garage, right? It depends on your use case. You need to think how you need to protect the system. So once again, the multi-factor authentication. It can once again think of as a defense in depth application, right? You need to log into a system with username and password. Then again, use something you know or something you have or something you want. So how many of you are familiar with threat modeling? So any application, before we put into production, we should do this exercise. So with threat modeling, what we do is, first we come up with a diagram. So this diagram will show all the components in our system. Basically, this is a deployment diagram and all the connections, right? So we have the application server, and the application server connects to a database system, to an LDAP server, to the file system. And how do you get to the application server? Okay, there's a connection through a firewall from the DMC. Then how do people get into the DMC? Okay, there's a reverse proxy. So everything should be in this diagram. So now we identify all the components and the connections between these components. Then we can define all possible threats for these connections. If it's a web application, then what are the possible threats? There can be cross-site scripting attacks, cross-site request forgery attacks, SQL injection attacks, then so many other attacks, right? you need to list out all these attacks for each connection. Right? First, you identify all possible threats. Once you identify proper threats, all possible threats, then you need to come up with a set of test cases to test these scenarios. Right? Basically, try to execute these attacks. Once you execute these attacks, you will end up with the vulnerabilities. Right? So you have a diagram, then identify threats, then you come up with the vulnerabilities, then execute the mitigation steps. Then validate that and continue that in a circle in whenever you do an update in your production deployment system. Yeah. So any questions up to now? So next I will move into some of the practical use cases and how we can solve those problems by applying patterns. Okay. So let me read through this. This is the problem statement. A medium scale enterprise has a limited number of RESTful APIs. These APIs should only be accessed by company employees via single web application. While they are behind the company firewall, all the user data is stored in an Active Directory and the web application is connected to it to authenticate users. The web application passes the logged in user's identifier to the backend API and retrieves data related to the user. So you have a web application, a user logs in the web application, and web application needs to access a backend API to retrieve user's data. So I have highlighted some of the important words here. Should only be accessed by the company employees, and this is a single web application. And then the application in all API calls passes the user's identifier. Right? So basically the application is not accessing backend APIs on behalf of the user. Application itself accesses and we pass the user's identifier in the API. So how do we implement this? So you have the application server where we have deployed the APIs. Then the application server which hosts the web app. Then the end user, right? So end user authenticates the web app. Web application connects to the Active Directory and authenticates the user. Now that's done. Now how do we secure this connection from the web application to the application server to the API? So here the catch is the web app needs not to access the backend API on behalf of the user. It accesses the backend API as a system. The user is already authenticated. The APIs do not need to authenticate the user. APIs need to authenticate the system which accesses the API. So this pattern is called the trusted subsystem pattern, and we can use TLS mutual authentication to secure that channel. So basically the web app, the application server will have a client certificate, and that client certificate is trusted by the API. Any question on that? So what if the backend API is SOAP. The TLS mutual oath is transport level security. Right. We can use the same thing for SOAP if that is access code HTTP. Right. So the SOAP is not bound to any transport protocol. Right. You can access a SOAP service over HTTP, SMTP, or any other transport layer protocol. So you can use TLS mutual oath, or else you can use message level security. TLS is transport level security. message level security, we can use WS security standard for SOAP. How many of you heard of WS security? Okay. So WS security is a standard built on top of XML signature and XML encryption. Right. So XML encryption talks about how to encrypt an XML message. Right. So you have the XML message, you encrypt it, and we have to put the encrypted data, we have to put the certificates used for encryption. So all those are defined in a standard manner in the XML encryption specification. Then the XML signature defines how to sign an XML message. Right. Whether they use envelope signature or detached signature like that. So there are different types of signatures. Then, so everything SOAP is XML, right? Everything SOAP is XML, but everything XML is not SOAP, right? SOAP is a standard built on top of XML and it defines, this is a schema for a SOAP payload. So, we cannot exactly use XML signature and XML encryption in SOAP world. So, there came the WS security standard. So, WS security standard defines how to use XML encryption and XML signature for SOAP messages. Right? It's that simple. If you have seen, you know that's simple. Right? So, yes, so you can use either TLS mutual load or sign and encryption with SOAP. So once again, what are the differences between transport level security and message level security? So what are the differences? So transport level security means we rely on the transport to protect our messages, right? So we compile our message. We don't worry about security of the message as a developer, right? We compile our message, just put in the transport, and we expect the transport channel to be a secure channel, right? With message level security, we don't rely on the transport. We build our message, we encrypt the message, or we sign the message, and then we put it in the transport. So you can use a message which is encrypted or any unsecured transport. Then again, the key differences are, due to the same fact I just explained, transport level security is point to point. Message level security is end to end. What does that mean? So if you, end to end means, it's just between two servers, or your client and the server. If there's a proxy in the middle, then once again, your TLS connection or the transport level connection can be removed. Especially like if you go through a proxy, then there can be new TLS connections being constructed. And there are two modes to do that. One is TLS tunneling and the other one is TLS bridging. So in TLS bridging, you create a new TLS connection at each hop. If you use TLS tunneling, then basically you create an end-to-end tunnel between the client and the server. So that's the default option or the safer option we use. But message level security is end-to-end. From the point you build the message to the point you decrypt the message, it's secure. Right? So those are the two major differences. So once again, with TLS or the transport level security, you cannot achieve like partial encryption. You cannot just encrypt a part of the message. But if you are doing message level encryption, you can encrypt whatever the parts of the message you want. In terms of performance, what is better? TLS, the transport level security, it's like 100 times better than message level encryption. Okay, so we covered some of the ground here. Next one, it's the same use case, so I'm not going to repeat it, but if you look at the last line, it's on behalf of the logged in user, right? So that means The API doesn't need to, does not need to trust the system. It has to authenticate the end user. Right? So once again, I'll make it clear. It's not basically authenticating the end user. It needs to verify that this user, this system is accessing this API on behalf of the user. So how to do that? So the best example is, right? So if you go to how many of you use TweetPic? So earlier Twitter didn't have the like facility to tweet images. Now it has, right? TweetPic came up, like you can tweet images from TweetPic. So first you need to log into TweetPic and upload your image. Then you had to give your Twitter username and password of TweetPic. Right? So you gave your Twitter username and password of TweetPic. Then TweetPic uses the Twitter API to tweet the image. Right? So the issue there was, we were giving our Twitter username and password to a third party. Right? So that's a concern. The ideal scenario would be, so we log into TweetPic, TweetPic should be able to access Twitter on behalf of us. Right? So do that, we can give a temporary token to TweetPic. So we authenticate to Twitter, so we go to TweetPic, I click on tweet, then TweetPic will redirect to Twitter. Now I authenticate to Twitter, right? And Twitter will send back a temporary token to TweetPic. So that temporary token represents me, the Twitter user, and also TweetPic. Now TweetPic can use that token to access the API. Right? So looking at the API, Twitter can identify whether this is being authorized by me to TweetPic. Right? So that is the whole concept behind OAuth. How many of you are familiar with OAuth? How many of you are using OAuth? How many of you are using login Facebook? Okay. So login, the protocol or behind the login Facebook is, Facebook login is basically the OAuth 2. Right? So OAuth is a standard for access delegation. So here the ideal solution is based on OAuth. So this is how it works. So you have the application server. So user comes to the application server. And application server will redirect the user when you click on the login to the OAuth authorization server. From there, user types his username and password. Then the authorization server will validate the credentials against Active Directory. Then send the response back to the application server. And so I'm not going to like cover the details of OAuth. So that's a grant response. OAuth has different grant types. So somehow at the end of this flow 2 and 3, application server knows who the user is and also it will get an access token, a temporary token. Now application server can use that token in step 4 to access the APIs in the backend server. Now that token goes to the application server with the token, the request goes to the application server with the token. Then application server extract out the token and talks to the authorization server to validate the token. If it's a valid token, then the application server can find out who the user and who the service provider or the web application. And then it can let the user in. Any question on that? So if you are not that familiar with OAuth, maybe you read a bit about how OAuth works and the concepts behind that. And if you need any information, like feel free to talk to me after session. Then again, so this is for RESTful APIs, right? So how about SOAP? Yeah.
What's the best way to give the token to the user so he can send it on every request?
Yeah. So this the user won't see this token. So my answer is not 100% correct. That's a one scenario where the user sees the token, but most of the scenarios user doesn't see the token. This token, so after the, so this is a browser redirect, right? So in number, in step 3, what you get is a code, which is temporary code, right? That is, that can be seen by the user. Now once you get the token, application server will talk to the token endpoint of the authorization server, passing that code and get the access token. So that access token is not visible to the end user, but only to the web app. Right? So using that access token, you can access the API. So as I said before, my answer is not 100% correct. The reason is, in OAuth, there are four grant types in the specification. Those are authorization code, implicit, client credentials, and resource owner password. In implicit grant type, end user can see the token. Right? Implicit grant type is used basically for JavaScript clients. Right? So you talk to the server, you get the code, and code is the access token comes in the URL as a URI fragment. So basically, even the backend won't see it, only the JavaScript can access the URI fragment. Your browser won't send back the URI fragments to the application server. So JavaScript can read it and access the API. So that is mostly for untrusted clients. Did I answer your question? So if it is so, how do we do that? Our challenge here is to access the backend service on behalf of the logged in user, right? So this is how you do it. So in SOAP world, there's another standard called WS Trust. So WS Trust is once again a specification built on top of WS Security, which tells you how to facilitate federation scenarios. So basically, how to build trust between service providers and IT providers. Now when the user comes to the application server can directly ask users username and password and then talk to an API in SDS and get a SAML token. That's one thing. Disadvantage of that is, this user has to give username and password to the application server directly. Right? The other approach is, the application server can redirect the user to the SDS using SAML web-based SSO. So once again, SAML web-based SSO is a standard to facilitate single sign-on. Right? So you authenticate here and you send back the SAML assertion to the application server. Now using that SAML assertion, the web app can construct a SOAP message with a WS Security header, embed that SAML assertion. It has to go as a supporting token, right? Because this is using bearer token. So if you are not familiar with WS Security stuff, just go in, right? So it has to go as a bearer token. Now it goes to the SOAP service, right? It extracts out the SOAP token from, extract out the SAML token from the SOAP envelope. Then that SAML token has to be signed. That has to be signed by this IDP. You validate the signature. If that validation is fine, you can log in. That's a normal SDS scenario. But in this case, application server has to access the service on behalf of this user. Right? When you issue a token from here to a service provider, that's an element called audience restriction element. So that means this can only be consumed by the internet audience. So now the application server cannot directly use that token to access SOAP service. So you need to talk here, send a SOAP request, the original SAML token, and get a new token. And use that token to access the SOAP service. So this is done using the ACTAS attribute introducing WS Trust 1.4 standard. So just if you don't understand WSO2 soft security stuff, just keep in mind this can be done. Any questions on that? How many of you are using WSO2? Are you using WSO2? So the third one, a medium scale enterprise has a limited number of RESTful APIs. These APIs should only be accessed by company employees, but here with multiple web applications. Right? In previous scenario, it's a single web app, so you can just authenticate the web app. But here it's using multiple web applications, so we need to make sure user only needs to authenticate once, right? When, like, he can log into multiple web applications, but user should only authenticate once. Like, you only need to provide username and password only once. So while they are under company firewall, all the user data are stored in an Active Directory, and all the web applications are connected to a SAML2 IT provider. So SAML2 over here used as the single sign-on protocol. Then the web application need to access the backend APIs on behalf of the logged in user. So this is once again similar. I'll walk you through the steps. So user comes to the web application. So the web application will create a SAML request and then redirect the user to the SAML2 identity provider. User authenticates the IDP. Then the IDP will create a SAML response and send it to the application server. So now you have a SAML token. Now in the previous scenario, previous slide, we created SOAP envelope embedding this SAML token. But now this is a RESTful service. We need to get an access token. Just having a SAML token, we cannot access the API, right? So we need to exchange this SAML token for an access token. So there is something called SAML grant type 4.0, right? So you can, the application server can pass this SAML token in step 4 to the OAuth authorization server. And if the OAuth authorization server trusts the SAML IDP, it will validate the token and issue an access token. Then it's the same flow after that. So you have the access token, you access the API using the access token, and the resource server, the API, will talk to the authorization server to validate the access token. Any questions? Okay, the fourth one. The first of same on behalf of the login user. But here, in previous scenario, user had to enter his username and password to the IDP, SAML IDP. Assume this is a Windows environment where you have enabled integrated Windows authentication, right? You log into the Windows machine, you should be able to access any APIs, right? You should be able to access any website. So that is the use case. So how to facilitate that? So the beauty here is all of the federation protocols, SAML, OpenID Connect, WS Federation, all these protocols, they talk about how to transport requests and responses. They don't talk about how to authenticate users at the IDP. We can authenticate users with username and password, certificates, IWA, or anything. Right? This is how it works here. So user now, I log into the Windows machine. So I have a Windows session, right? So that can be based on NTLM, okay, Bruce. Now, I go to the web app. So web app will create a SAML request and redirect me to SAML IDP. Now, SAML IDP, we can enable IWA-based authentication. So here you don't ask user to enter username password, but IDP will automatically authenticate you using your Windows session and create a SAML response and send back to the web app. After that, it's the same flow as in the previous one. Right? So from the user's experience, this is seamless. Fifth pattern. Right? So here, so what's the difference? A medium Okay, so the difference is all the previous scenarios, it's just the employees from the company who want to access this website, right? In this scenario, this API should be accessed by company employees as well as employees from trusted partners, right? So how to do that? So we have two domains. So this is one domain, this is a partner domain, and this is our domain, right? So this is our application server. This is our application server. If this is an internal user, this is an internal user, he comes to the application server. This application server only trusts your own ID, your own SAML ID provider, right? So irrespective of who the user is, whenever the application finds out there is no authenticated session there, user will be redirected to the to its trusted IDP, right? It's an internal IDP. Now if you're an internal user, I can authenticate with IWA or with username and password, right? Then it will generate some response and send. But if I'm a partner, then I should be able to pick my IDP. SAML IDP there will have a link to my IDP, partner IDP. Then I click that link, then in two way I'll be redirected to the SAML 2 IDP in my domain. I'll authenticate there. This will generate SAML response, which is signed by this IDP. Since this IDP trusts this partner IDP, the accept the SAML response, and it will create its own SAML response and send to the application server that is signed by this IDP. And since this application trusts this one, it will let the user in. So this is how the federation scenarios work. And then again, if you go to access an API, you can exchange that SAML token for access token, token to your authorization server. Any questions on that? Then the sixth pattern, so the same thing, instead of the SAML IDP, now we are using an OpenID Connect IP provider. The flow would be same, but here it's not a SAML IDP, but an OpenID Connect IP provider. So basically, what you get in the response here, instead of SAML response, it's ID token. So ID token is a JWT, or known as JSON Web Token. Any of you heard of JSON Web Token, JWT? Yeah. So there's a working group called QCA working group, JOSA, and IDF. So that working group is working on JWT, JSON Web Signature, JWS, and JWE, JSON Web Encryption. So basically now, everything you see in the SAML world or XML world is now there for JSON. You can do message level encryption in JSON with JWE in standard manner. You can do message level signature in JSON world using JWS. Right? So this JWT is a signed message just like a SAML token, but instead of XML, here we are using JSON. So now it is passed to the application server and it will validate the signature of the ID token. And if it wants to access an API, once again APIs are secured with OAuth2o access tokens. So then you will exchange the ID token to an access token using the OAuth JWT grant type of OAuth and access API. Okay. So then this is a simple scenario. So how do you achieve non-repudiation in JSON world? So once again, the non-repudiation means you do it once, later you cannot deny. You do it once, you own it all. You own it ever, right? So how do we achieve non-repudiation? We achieve non-repudiation by signing. You sign a message and you are the only person who owns the private key, right? The way to do that in JSON world is using JSON Web Signature and JSON Web Encryption. So this is so here I'll explain the go through the problem statement. So this medium scale enterprise that says bottled water has a RESTful API. Let's say water API, right? So this water company exposes an API called water API, which can be used to update amount of water consumed by a registered user, right? So you have sensors in the water bottle. So you drink water and then go to the water API and update how much water you drink in the day, right? And this API should only be accessed by any registered user via any client application, right? So anybody can build applications, right? Anybody can create applications against these APIs, but they should access these APIs on behalf of the end user, right? And then again, this water API should be able to update another API on behalf of that user. That is called the health API, right? The problem here is, I have application, I access the data application, and application access an API, and API access another API, right? So I need to have a valid account in both APIs, right? The way it happens is, there's something called chain grant typing mode, right? So I access this API, giving my access token to the web app, right? Then web app access the water API, giving that access token, you validate that access token. Then the water API needs to access the health API. Then water API must get another access token. You pass this access token to a trusted authorization server, get a new access token, and use that access token to access the health API. So this here we use the chain grant type in WSO2. Since we are running out of time, I guess there are only like 5 minutes remaining. I'll skip some of this stuff. And so you go to the blog.facilelogin.com. Also, I write a blog on API secret group called blog.api-secret.org. So I have listed all these patterns, and also in the last chapter of my book, so I discuss all these patterns. I guess we are giving away some books at our WSO2 booth. You can just pick a book from there too. Now I'll share these slides. I mean, to skip some of this stuff, but I'll cover this one. So this is how we can integrate access controlling for RESTful APIs. Right. The way this happens is, so user goes to the web application, you will be redirected to the authorization server using any of the OAuth grant types, then you get an access token. Using that access token, you want to access the backend API. Right? Then we will put an API gateway in the middle, which will intercept all the requests. Now you get the access token. API gateway will talk to the authorization server to validate the token. Right? There's a specification called OAuth introspection API. So that's a standard API that has to be implemented by the OAuth servers. You pass the access token, and in the response of the introspection API, you will get an active token, the sports associated with the access token, then the user who approved the token, then the application who initiated this transaction. Now the API gateway gets the introspection response. Using introspection response, you can build the SACMAL request. So how many of you heard of SACMAL? So SACMAL is the de facto standard for fine-grained access control. Right? In SACMAL, you can define authorization rule saying a user who belongs to the rule foo should be able to access the resource bar if his email address is from WSO2. On any given weekday during 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. if his age is greater than 18, something like that. To any level of granularity, you can go with SACMAL. So here, you create a SACMAL request from the API gateway and from the introspection response. And SACMAL PDP, or the policy decision point, evaluate the policies and send back the response. And if it is permit, then the API gateway will let the user access the API. So we have implemented, in the WSO2 stack, with WSO2 application server, USB, API gateway, add-in server, so we can support almost all these patterns. And some of the specifications we haven't implemented yet, but they are in our roadmap that will be done in future releases. Yeah, so as Asaka mentioned, so we have a party today at 7:30 p.m. and it's only by invite, and all of you are welcome to attend that. Any questions, you can ask now, or even you can come anytime to our WSO2 booth just there. Any questions?